How you doing? This is Mike Anderson, and I'm going to show you a couple of instruments in this little video. World class. They're very popular in early Illinois and all the settlements and things like that, all across the Midwest and across the country. But they're also world class instruments. Almost every culture around the world has got these instruments. Here's the first one. These are bones. Literally, these are bones. These are cow ribs. And playing the bones was one of the earliest instruments. As a matter of fact, I would say bones were the top three. As people started, they used their voice, then they started banging things together. Hands probably came next, and then rocks and sticks and whatever they had around. Anyway, I wasn't there. I don't honestly know. But bones, a common part of any homestead. And to play the bones probably started off nice and simple. You take two bones and you hit them together, and you could do anything you can sing with it. Something like, the itsy bitsy spider went up the water spout, down came the rain, washed the spider out, out came the sun, dried up all the rain, and itsy bitsy spider went up the spout again. Yeah, just something that simple. But as you get older, you're going to find out that people tend to complicate anything. They make it harder. So to play the bones nowadays, you take your quiet sign and you put the bone between it, and you press your middle finger down on it and you push it into your hand. Now, all the folk instruments are relatively easy, but they all have a tricky bit. And once you figure out the tricky bit, you're okay. That's the tricky bit for the bones. You gotta press it down into your hand. It has to stay there. You can't move your hand and have it come up. It's gotta stay. One finger over, that one's loose. And then you flick your wrist and it goes ticketa ticketa. There we go. And you can do your song, whatever you would like to do. Now, these are very large and heavy, and they're what I learned on. And they're not easy to play. That's a better sound right there. They're not easy to play because they are so very, very large. So I found another cow, and I got these. These are also from a cow. These are the cow's leg. You have a very large bone, and so does the cow, a very large bone between your knee and your thigh. It's called the femur, F-E-M-U-R. And these are the femur of a cow. And they sound, of course, they've been shaped and they've been sanded and they've been worked on. They don't look like this in the cow. And they sound like this. Much smoother, much lighter. Much lighter. I want to say that, boy, my arm doesn't fall off halfway through the song. And with this, you can do just about anything. Something like, another classic. Twinkle, twinkle, little star, how I wonder what you are. Up above the world so high, like a diamond in the sky. Twinkle, twinkle, little star, how I wonder what you are. The bones. In early Illinois and across the Midwest and back in the mountains out east, and as you head west in the Civil War, the bones were half of the dance band. If you had a party, if you had a gathering of any kind and there was dancing or there was going to be music, half of the dance band were the bones. That's the percussion. The other half was this. It was an instrument made by the local blacksmith out of iron and then some spring steel, which is the thing they made the springs for the covered wagons and things. It made the ride a little easier. It was a bouncy sort of steel, very thin. And it looks like this. It's an ancient, ancient instrument. They come from all over the world. All over the world has got these instruments. And this is a jaw harp, or a mouth harp, or a Snoopy harp, or a frog fiddle, a Tennessee Toothbuster, because it can do that. You put your teeth on this instrument. That's the tricky bit. Most people, you're told to stick it in your mouth and hit it, and you stick it in your mouth and you hit the middle bar, which goes back and forth, and you get, and it hurts. And you can break your teeth. These things are not totally safe. So be very, very careful if you try one. But here's the tricky bit, which will make them safer. You put your teeth on the top bar and the bottom bar. There's three bars here. There's one in the middle that moves. Then you got one on the top and one on the bottom. And those are where your teeth go. And then you lower your lips. And then you add breath, and that gives you rhythm and some backbeat. The boingy boingy sound is when you move your tongue. You direct the air as to which way you want it to go through the jaw harp, and you get. You've heard the sound effect a lot. It's used in cartoons. And any place you need sort of a funny little filler sound, here's a frog on a cartoon. So, you've heard jaw harps a lot. You just didn't know what it was. You might have thought it was a spring or just some sound effect. But it's most likely somebody playing the jaw harp. And the jaw harp, like I say, comes from all over the world. This is the style we have here in North America. It came from Europe, and it's just a heavy iron frame with the spring steel in the middle. And that style, I mean, this is just one style. This one was actually made in the country of Hungary, which is over in Europe. This one's from Hungary. Here's one from Sicily. Look at the size of that thing compared. Quite a bit different in size. This one's from Sicily, which is down at the bottom of Italy in Europe. And it doesn't play very well, but and I don't like to play it because it really rattles my teeth. Here's another one. Well, this one here comes from India. And it's got this extra tail down here, which means I can lean my hand against it, push it, and change the tone. Now, I'm not going to play this one because it's not a very good musical instrument. It was made to be bought by tourists. So it's not really a good instrument. But it's a good demonstration. And then, here's one from Russia. Look at the size of this thing. Here's the first one I played. Amazing difference. And the difference in tone is because of the different size. This one's much heavier. The bar that's moving, the spring steel, is much longer, which means all the notes are going to be lower. Here's this one. And then you got this one. Totally, totally different sound. The jaw harps from all over the world, it amazes me how alike people are. The people who developed these instruments that I've shown you didn't even know the other people existed on the earth. There was no communications, not much travel, so they didn't even know that someone in Sicily was developing this. At the same time, someone in Russia was developing this. But they came up with the same thing. Now, along those same lines, this is one from Southeast Asia, Vietnam to be exact. It's got a nice little colorful case, and on the inside you have the instrument. It's very lightweight and small, about the same size as the first one. And the wonderful thing about this one It's made out of brass, by the way. The wonderful thing about this one is I don't put my teeth on it. These are safe. They're the easiest ones to play that I've found in the world. And you get... Waterbound and I can't go home. Waterbound and I can't go home. Waterbound, can't go home down in Louisiana. The old man's mad, but I don't care. The old man's mad, but I don't care. Old man's mad, I don't care, long as I kiss his daughter. So I'm waterbound and I can't go home. Waterbound, I can't go home. Waterbound, can't go home down in North Carolina. The jaw harp, it's a great instrument. It's a great instrument. If you get one, please be careful because our European style can hurt your teeth and your mouth and your tongue and your lips, anything that it hits. You find one from Southeast Asia, they're called a Danmoi, D-A-N-M-O-I. Those are the safe ones, but you don't find them around very, very much. And by the way, the jaw harp is said to be the only musical instrument that Abraham Lincoln played on a regular basis. So, thanks so much for listening. Enjoy yourself. Be safe.